Good afternoon. Welcome to the 8th Annual Senior Showcase. We are delighted that you are joining us today to hear from four Wake Forest University undergraduate students who have conducted outstanding research in the fields of music history, economics, physics, and chemistry. I am Molly Keener, Director of Digital Initiatives and Scholarly Communication here at the Z. Smith Reynolds Library, and it has been my pleasure to coordinate the Senior Showcase since its inception in 2010. From the beginning, the Senior Showcase has been an intrinsically student-focused program of the library. It was founded upon the suggestion of a former Wake Forest student who, inspired by the rich diversity of his peers' research projects, sought a forum for their research to be shared more broadly with the campus community. He pitched his idea to Lynn Sutton, who at the time was the dean of the library and who now is the university's vice provost. She, in turn, put the two of us together, and through our collaboration, the Senior Showcase program came to be. And as Lynn Sutton is joining us today for her final Senior Showcase, I do wish to extend a special note of thanks for 8 years of incredible support for this program. In addition to the library administration support, both past and present, the showcase is reliant upon the continued support of college faculty and my fellow library faculty. Nominations for this year's showcase were submitted earlier in the semester by college faculty who, in working with our undergraduates on their senior research, are able to identify those students who are going above and beyond expectations. From those nominations, final selections were made by a jury panel of library faculty. Selection decisions were based upon both the strength of the faculty's nomination and review of the students' works. The four students selected for the 2017 Senior Showcase are Kevin Kloss, Economics, Tyler Dean, Chemistry, Angela Harper, Physics, and Jeremy Sexton, Music. Each honoree will share their research in 12 to 15 minutes, and we do ask that you hold questions for a joint question and answer period following all presentations. To conclude the showcase, we hope you will stay and visit with our honorees during a reception organized by Sophie Levique, the ZSR Library Fellow. And I must also thank my ZSR colleague, Barry Davis, for the technical support he is giving us today. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our first speaker. Today's first presentation is from Kevin Kloss. Kevin is an economics major and a journalism minor. He is from Holmdel, New Jersey, and following graduation, Kevin will be teaching middle school English at a charter school in Newark, New Jersey, through the Teach for America program.
Okay, first of all, I want to thank Dr. Griffith and Dr. Dalton, who advised me the whole way through this process. It was a great experience, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate all the support that you gave me. My senior thesis was called Determinants of Post-Education Success. As mentioned, I'm going to be a teacher next year, so education policy was always something that had interested me. So I wanted to take a little bit of a look about what makes a successful student and what makes a successful person after they finish their schooling. So I want to start off by looking at a few macro-level data points that may seem obvious but will provide a good foundation for the rest of the research. As you can see, the average income of a individual is highly correlated with their race, and that spills into education when you look at standardized test performance that is largely based along the same lines. Just as white and Asian families tend to have higher income, they also tend to score higher on standardized test scores, while black and Hispanic students tend to lag a little further behind. While that may not be particularly newsworthy to you, something that I did find a little interesting when I first started looking at some of this data, is when I looked at who completes the most homework. I was looking for reasons of why it's possible some students perform better than others. So I thought homework was a good staple of American education that all students love to hate. And I wanted to see if it's correlated with higher grades. And I found not really, at least not on a macro level. For elementary school students, black students tend to spend more time per week than white students studying. And not only that, but the parents of black students actually check their homework completion more frequently than their white counterparts, which itself doesn't tell you that homework is worthless or doesn't work. In fact, there's many studies that show it does show a lot of student growth. All that really tells us is that there are other factors that make a good student, and a successful person. So from there, I wanted to see what are these other factors that influence it. And drawing on the economic and social science concepts of human capital, cultural capital, and social capital, I wanted to see which one was more indicative of a high-performing student. With human capital being skills that one would learn in school, reading and writing, that can make them a productive member of the labor force. Cultural capital being certain societal advantages that they may have, dressing the right way, talking the right way, being from a family of status, that may give them some advantages. And then the social capital being relationships that they have either with their family, or with their school community, their friends, but for this research, most notably with their parents, the relationship between a child and a parent. So I looked for some individuals who I could track over the course from their education into the beginning of their professional careers to see what factors are most indicative of a successful student. A little over 3,600 subjects from a longitudinal study that was first. They were first surveyed when they were either a sophomore or senior in high school, which puts them about age 15 to 18, and follows them for about 9 years to see what students perform better on standardized test scores, what students are more likely to go to college, and who earns more once students finish their education and begin professional life. So based on my sample demographic, before I get into any of the regressions that I ran, we can observe that white and Asian students do, in fact, have the most inherited social and cultural capital, as defined by having parents with higher income, having parents with college degrees, and the fact that they tend to come from more stable families. They are more likely to live with both of their parents than their black or Hispanic counterparts. However, there's a common myth or idea that you hear that's actually not even that fringe of an idea, that that perhaps black students aren't as high performing because they don't try as hard, they're not as focused in school. In fact, just last week a survey came out from the Washington Post, and when white Americans were asked why is there racial disparity in wealth and education, about 40% of white people said it was because blacks lack the motivation. However, my data contradicts that pretty clearly. As can be observed, when teachers are surveyed of their students within my sample, there was no difference detected between the effort being given by a white student as opposed to a black student or a Hispanic student. In fact, black and Hispanic parents were reported to be more involved in their children's education than their white counterparts, probably because a lot of schools tend to emphasize that a lot more in communities like that. But it does dispel that myth pretty clearly that black students just aren't trying as hard. So the regression models I chose to run, I wanted to see what factors determine standardized test scores, the likelihood of someone pursuing education past high school, not necessarily finishing any degree past high school, but just the fact that they will pursue additional education, and a vague idea of how much students can be expected to earn once they finish their education and they're a few years out of school. So the variables I considered to measure what we consider to be human capital, or efforts to improve their human capital, would be how much time they spend studying. And I included a second variable for homework to see whether or not there's a certain limit as to a point where homework becomes not beneficial anymore. So there's some interesting results from that later. But I created a quadratic to see, is there a certain point where homework actually becomes a negative influence on a child's education? I wanted to see how often a parent checks their homework. Does that impact? How often do they miss it? If their teachers consider them a hard worker, do they earn good grades in school? Are they academically recognized? And how involved do teachers believe their parents are in their education? Being that 15 and 17-year-olds have hardly had an opportunity to create their own identity yet, I worked under the assumption that all social and cultural capital was inherited from their upbringing. So to measure that, I recorded their I used their parents' income, whether or not their parents themselves had received a college degree, whether or not their parents work, whether or not their mom works, or if they have a stay-at-home mother, whether they are fluent in English, if their parents are fluent in English, what language is first spoken at home, in addition to whether or not they live with both of their parents to try and determine the structure of the family. And the results were fairly shocking and a little disheartening to me. Anyway, on a standardized test model where the average score is a 50 and the students can score between 20 and 80 while holding everything else equal, just being a black female who lives with only one parent takes 7 points off your standardized test scores. And I guess a positive of that would mean that would be that you can earn a higher score through hard work, but unfortunately it's actually even less than just the disadvantage of being a black female from a single parent household is. That would only add 6 points to your score, which is a little disheartening. So I wanted to use an example of two hypothetical students to see which student based on my model would theoretically earn a higher standardized test score. You have one who is a hard worker, one who is academically recognized, but their parents only make $40,000 a year. Another one is not considered to be a hard worker by their teachers, is not academically recognized, but their parents make $155,000 a year. And based on that, we actually do expect for the higher income student to earn better standardized test scores just based simply off that. And I want to emphasize that this does not even take into consideration race or family stability. And that oftentimes compounds problems for lower income people. So this was a very disheartening finding for me to see how directly related income is to student performance, almost regardless of the effort that's given in. When I ran results to see which students were most likely to go to college, again, it seemed even more so than income this time. It seemed whether or not your parents had gone to college was in fact the biggest indicator of whether or not you would continue to seek education after school. On a 100% point model, just having a parent who went to college and got a degree added 52 percentage points to the likelihood that you yourself, and being that parents who have college degrees tend to earn more than those who don't, there's an additional benefit to having parents who go to college. And perhaps even dishearteningly as well, missing homework assignments and number of hours you spent on homework did not seem to be very influential on whether or not you yourself went to college. It seemed it was largely based on whether or not your parents did. So looking at two more hypothetical students, the financial difference isn't even that large in this one, but if you have a hard worker who is academically recognized by their school, but the parents did not go to college, it seems to only take $17,000 more in income and a parent who did go to college for a not academically recognized student to go to college, which is a pretty disturbing figure to me. And it just shows you how much work we have to do in improving our education system and to making it where if you work hard, then you can be rewarded and with a college degree. In terms of my results for the earnings model, those I guess shine a little happier picture. It did seem that those who were recognized for hard work and good grades in school did earn more when they were in their early to mid 20s. However, the bad news is I don't put much weight on this because it seemed as if those with the highest standardized test scores and those who tend to, or those of Asian descent actually made less at this time, which would suggest that they could possibly be in graduate school, which would make their income zero. If the highest standardized test scores were having negative effects on income, I figured there was probably something wrong. So there is reason to doubt that finding right there. So overall findings were fairly upsetting to me, that inherited social and cultural capital does seem to be the number one predictor of how well you will score on standardized tests and whether or not you yourself will go to college. And I mentioned before, I tried to figure out whether or not there was an ideal time, amount of time to spend on homework, and I actually did find to a statistically significant degree that for every hour of homework done past 15 hours a week, there actually was a negative impact on students, which I found to be interesting. And that was actually in line with past data that suggested that shorter assignments were better than longer assignments for students. Some final reflections I have on this. If I could improve this research a little more, I would want to find a way to account for clustering of where people live, because of the subjective measurements of what is a hard worker and what is academically a good student does vary based on what school you're in. So may have affected the results just a little bit. I'd have loved to be able to control for that. And if I really wanted to see how stuff like this affects earnings in one's career, I would want to do it when they're probably in their 30s or 40s, as opposed to mid-20s, so that they were established. So as I go into the classroom as a school teacher next year, I'm keeping this in mind, hoping that I can make it just a little bit better. I thank you for inviting me here. I would be more than happy to share my paper with anyone or answer any questions you have. So thank you.
Our second presenter today is Tyler Dean, who is majoring in chemistry with a concentration in biochemistry and minoring in biology. Tyler is from New Orleans and will be working in a pharmacology lab at Louisiana State University School of Medicine next year while applying to MD and MD-PhD programs. Tyler?
Hi, thank you all for coming today. So my project is titled Design of Gold-Based Trojan Horse Therapies for Treating Autoimmune Disorders. So I'll go a little bit into what really I mean by Trojan Horse Therapies later on in my presentation. But first, I'll give a little bit of background on autoimmune disease. So autoimmune disease is caused by self-reactive T cells that come about through many different mechanisms. So normally the body has different ways of preventing these T cells from proliferating. But in the case of autoimmune disease, either through a genetic complication or through just failed control mechanisms from mutations, these mechanisms are faulty. And so these antibodies that are self-reactive proliferate, and you can get these just random cell death and then antigens resulting from the death of cells. So antigen is just any sort of protein or any material in a cell or in a biological system. And these antibodies can incorrectly become complementary to those naturally human products. And that causes, in other situations, for these antibodies to bind to normal cells and recruit T cells that result in the death of healthy cells that would normally proliferate normally and healthfully in regular people. And so autoimmune disease is a really big problem, and the current treatment is pretty bad, to be honest. Immunosuppression. So basically what you do is you give drugs that suppress the normal immune system. And so these T cells are, instead of attacking foreign things, they're just not attacking anything at all. And that's to prevent the T cells from attacking normal cells. And so this results in immunocompromised patients, so the normal flu can become a life-threatening illness. And so there's a real big problem with current treatment of autoimmune diseases. And then just one glaring example that I thought of is this compound right here, And so it's called cyclophosphamide. It's a drug that's used in treatment of graft versus host disease. And if you take off this phosphamide ring and add on another one of these ethyl chlorides, you have mustard gas, which was used in World War I as a war gas. And so I don't think it seems natural to treat immunocompromised patients with what was like formerly used to kill people in war. So that's why we're specifically targeting autoimmune disease, because there's a severe lack of treatment as of now. And so the specific disease that we thought of was lupus erythematosus. And so it's one of the most systemic forms of autoimmune disease. It affects nearly every tissue and organ system in the body. It's not usually fatal, but it has a severe just quality of life detriment to these patients. And so in the last 50 years, there was only one drug. It was released in 2011. And so there's, again, a severe lack of treatment for these diseases. And we see this as an avenue to help a lot of people, 5 million people to be particular, to be exact. And 20% of people with systemic lupus erythematosus, SLE, have a family member with it. So that indicates the genetic component of autoimmune disease. And so our strategy is to use gold-based compounds. And so the origins of gold-based compounds can be traced back to Robert Koch in 1882. He was a microbiologist who discovered Mycobacterium tuberculosis. He won the Nobel Prize for that in 1905. And tuberculosis back then was just horribly potent and deadly to patients, and there were not very many treatments. One thing that he found was a gold cyanide compound. So we know that cyanide is naturally a poison, but what he saw was that the gold cyanide compared to a sodium cyanide analog was 1,000 times more potent at killing the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. And so in vitro, it was incredibly effective. The cells didn't proliferate at all, but when he moved it on to mouse models, nearly all the mice died because of the systemic toxicity from the gold and the cyanide. And so he ultimately gave up on this targeted therapy of autoimmune diseases, but another German scientist, Adolf Felt, worked on gold one drugs to treat tuberculosis, and he came up with the Solgonal series in the 1920s. And so rather than having the incredibly toxic cyanide ligand, he has this thioglucose here and another sulfur-based ligand. And these were very effective in treating tuberculosis. They weren't as toxic, but they're still very toxic. And so from the 1920s up until 1985, there wasn't much improvement in the area of gold 1-based therapeutics. And so in 1985, Aranofin, which is a very similar drug, so it's this thioglucose with a triethylphosphine, it was released as a treatment for rheumatoid arthritis, and it was marketed as Redora. It's still a treatment, but right now it's the last line treatment of rheumatoid arthritis just because of its incredible toxicity. And so that, I think you can understand now, the big problem with gold drugs is the toxicity. It's very unspecific. It kills basically any cell that it gets into, and so controlling that toxicity is essential to the success of gold 1 drugs. And so my research originally stemmed from original attempts to treat cancer cells with these gold 1 drugs, because they show remarkable geometry similarity to cisplatin, which is a platinum 2 drug. They tried to use gold 3 as a treatment for various types of cancers, but it wasn't effective. But what they found is that it was effective in autoimmune disease, in autoimmune cells. And so that's where my research starts off. I work in Dr. Bierbach's lab, and we're usually a cancer focused lab, but my project is on autoimmune disease, obviously. And so we developed two drugs. So this is what we call PET3 gold or CRAM2, and this is what we call JohnFoss gold or CRAM2, and the JohnFoss is just this phosphine ligand here. It's complicated, I'm not gonna say the scientific name for it. And so our goal was to attenuate the systemic cytotoxicity while maintaining the incredible potency of these gold drugs. And so just to give kind of a visual of the potency of these drugs, one sugar cube in an Olympic-sized pool is enough to kill 50% of cells. So that's equivalent to a nanomolar. So that's incredibly potent, just to imagine that. And so the whole process of drug development, so we started with a library of 90 compounds. We did high throughput screening, and we identified these two compounds. And so my main role was to modify the and optimize the structure and delivery of these drugs. And so we had two main strategies to reduce the toxicity. So this is a crystal structure of the John Foss, and this is kind of exemplary of, or an example of one of the ways of attenuating the toxicity. You can see the phosphine ligand here serves to protect the gold molecule when it's in the body. And so you have those two phenyl rings protecting the gold molecule from one end, and then the tert-butyl groups protecting on the top. And so that prevents the gold from being attacked by any nucleophilic ligands in the body, which there are plenty. And so that's the main reason that there's so much toxicity, is gold just reacts with everything. And so another way was the right of the slide. And so this is human serum albumin, which is the most common protein in human blood. And it has one free sulfur, one free thiol, which is what gold loves to react to. And so what we did, or just this concept, is loading the drug onto these cysteines on proteins and purifying it. And now it's more biocompatible and bioavailable, which solves two problems for these gold drugs. So it's not going to be as reactive with biological cysteines because it's already attached to a biological cysteine. And it's also going to be delivered more effectively to the target cells. And so this is an ESI-TOF mass spec, so electrospiralization time of flight mass spec spectra of the two the human serum albumin loadings. So the top, this is the mass of human serum albumin unmodified, and then when reacted with our gold triethylphosphine, we see the creation of the one addition to HSA, which confirms our goal, which was to load it onto the protein. And then here, we see actually three additions of the bulkier ligand, and we can attribute this to the steric hindrance of the gold molecule, and which results in the gold molecule reacting with more sterically available ligands on the protein, such as methionine, which also contains a sulfur. And so from this, we confirmed that we loaded the protein, or the loaded the drug onto the protein, and we went to test it in T cells, in inhibiting the growth of T cells. And so this graph here shows the effect on the division of these cells. And so compound one is the triethylphosphine, compound two is the John Foss, human serum albumin is just the protein by itself. And then these are the two protein conjugates. And we saw that compound one versus compound one loaded onto human serum albumin, there was no loss in efficacy, which is really, really interesting, because we thought that maybe loading onto the protein will have some negative effect, such as like sequestering the gold somewhere or bringing it out of circulation, but we found that it was still incredibly effective. Again, one sugar cube in an Olympic-sized pool. And this is just a visual representation of that. So these are unstimulated T cells versus T cells that are proliferated, that have proliferated after stimulation, but we see no proliferation here, which is really, really cool. And so this is where the Trojan horse analogy comes in. So antibodies, as we talked about before, are heavily involved in autoimmune disease, and each autoimmune disease has specific antibodies that are antigens and antibodies that are presented on their cells. And so, for instance, CD8 and CD4 are two types that are presented in autoimmune cells. And these antibodies are incredibly specific for their ligand, and so they bind with picomolar affinities. So now instead of one sugar cube and one Olympic-sized pool, it's one sugar cube and 1,000 Olympic-sized pools. And so it's incredibly specific. And if we can load our drug onto these specific antibodies, we have the potential to target specific cells in a way that's currently being done, but it's never been done before for autoimmune disease. And so there are drugs that are used to treat cancer that have been released that have these antibodies with drug molecules loaded onto them, but there's no such thing for autoimmune disease. So this is a really cool opportunity. And so the kind of the last thing I did in my research was attempt to conjugate these antibodies with gold molecules. And so the way you do that, right, let me go back. So it's kind of small, but the structure of an antibody, you have two heavy chains in the middle and two light chains. And what holds together these heavy and light chains are disulfide bonds. And so what you can do is you can reduce these disulfide bonds with reducing agents such as TSEP or DTT, diethylethyl, and you release free cysteines that can be modified with our drug. And so that's what we did. We reduced the antibody and modified it with our gold molecule. And here is this part of the gel is modified with our compound 1. And these two bands are the important ones here. So this corresponds to half of the antibody, so one heavy chain and one light chain. And then this one corresponds to one heavy chain by itself. And so the way this works, this is an SDS page gel, lighter things travel further. And so the shift in the band here that can be seen on this arrow indicates that we have modified our antibody successfully with a gold drug. And just due to the shift. So this is heavier, so it doesn't move as much, and it's modified with a gold. And so this is really encouraging in terms of our goal to load these antibodies with drugs and then target specific cells to reduce the proliferation. And so just an overall look at my project. So it started with chemistry, simple synthesis, characterization, and model systems. So we didn't just use human serum albumin, we used other small molecules to confirm the loading of our gold onto cysteines. And then biochemistry, so protein modification, purification, and quantification. And then also immunology, looking at the proliferation of the cells. And so overall, this was by far my favorite part of the project, is I wasn't just stuck in the lab making different molecules. I was modifying proteins, I made molecules, I worked with biological systems. And unfortunately, I'm not going to be able to work with live mice, but the next person working on my project is, because we are ordering the mice as we speak. So that is exciting. And so lastly, I'd just like to thank Dr. Bierbach and the Bierbach group, specifically Mu Yang, who was the graduate assistant who helped with my project. They were all so awesome. Also Dr. Wright, Dr. Day, Dr. Ferdui, and Dr. Grayson for helping with my research. And finally, the whole reason I did this is I was named a Beckman Scholar the summer of my sophomore year. And so that funded my research and allowed me to do this, something that I've never done before. So yeah, I really enjoyed it. Thank you for listening.
Today's third presentation is from Angela Harper. Angela is from Downingtown, Pennsylvania, and is majoring in physics and double minoring in mathematics and computer science. Next year, she will be going to Cambridge University in England as a Churchill Scholar, earning a Master of Philosophy in Physics. After her year in Cambridge, she will matriculate to the University of California, Berkeley, for her PhD in material science and engineering. Angela?
Good afternoon, everyone. Again, my name is Angela Harper, and today I'm going to be talking to you all about laser-printed flexible electronics, a project that I've been working on for the past 2 years with postdoctoral researcher Peter Diemer and my professor, Juana Jurcescu. So flexible electronics are made from organic materials. Your cell phone, your computer, these are inorganic materials. But to make these materials flexible, we need to make them organic. So what does it mean for a material or a chemical product to be organic? So when you think of organic, you might be thinking of this symbol that you see on a lot of food packaging nowadays, USDA organic. I'll tell you right now, you don't want to eat the chemicals that we're using in this lab. This is not what we mean when we say organic chemistry. What we actually mean are carbon-based materials, so materials that are made primarily from carbon and other organic compounds. So these are the types of materials that I'm going to be telling you a little bit about today and the ones that I've been working with for the past 2 years. So some flexible electronics that you might have seen sold in some stores around the world are, first of all, flexible displays, such as the Samsung TV that's curved or this flexible LG display. Other applications are biosensors, sensors that can detect glucose in your body or things like this. Also, organic solar cells that are flexible. So right now, our solar cells are these large, strict, stiff panels. And with organics, we can make these solar cells potentially flexible. And finally, wearable technology, like this contact lens right here that's ideal for diabetic patients. It detects the glucose in your body and is able to respond to this and tell you when you need to take insulin. So these are some of the applications of organic electronics and why we actually care about working on this project. Some of the big benefits of organics are, first of all, their large-scale processing. Right now, you can process these organic materials at hundreds of feet per second. So this makes it really, really great for scaling up to the manufacturing level. And it's also very low cost. A lot of these organics are very cheap to process. In methods that we'll talk about later, we'll discuss how we're able to make these organic materials much lower cost to actually produce. Finally, we can use some different chemistry to make them environmentally friendly, which is very beneficial because we'd like our electronic devices to be environmentally friendly, especially when we dispose of them. It'd be great if these organic materials could be safe for the environment. And finally, like some of the applications that we talked about before, for biocompatibility, like the contact lens that you saw earlier that used organic electronics. So the device that I'm actually going to be talking to you about today is a very specific electronic device known as the organic field effect transistor. So what you're looking at right here is a schematic diagram of an organic transistor. And this transistor has a couple of different layers. The first layer down here is the gate. This gate is where we apply a voltage. We also apply a voltage at the source and the drain. And these different layers inside of it, a dielectric and a semiconductor, allow charges to behave a little bit differently inside of the transistor and allow it to function. So first, when we apply a voltage to the gate, as well as the source and the drain, we allow these charges right here to separate from the dielectric layer. But you can see right here there's this light bulb and we haven't turned on the light bulb yet. We need to connect something else in order to make this light bulb turn on. So by applying another voltage at the drain, we allow charges to flow in the semiconductor and we've turned on our light bulb. And right now, a lot of you are holding in your hands a lot of transistors. So transistors are the devices that make your computers work. They're the ones and zeros inside of your computer, inside of your cell phone. This is where you've used a transistor in your daily life, probably without even knowing it. So these are the devices that I've been making in the lab and the ones that we're going to be talking about today. To show you a little preview of some of the graphs that you're going to be seeing, these two graphs down here help describe our transistor working well. So by seeing different graphs like this, known as transfer and transport graphs, we know that our transistor is operating correctly. And if we see a figure of merit known as mobility, that's high, it describes that charges are moving well in our transistor. So with a high mobility and graphs such as the ones below, we know that our transistor is working well. So what I've done for the past 2 years is work on some processing techniques and talk a little bit about how we actually make each individual layer of this organic field effect transistor. And currently, there are two main methods by which we make these organic field effect transistors. The first on the left over here is vapor deposition. So right now, we're thermally evaporating organic material onto a substrate, which is at the top of this platform right here. And this will create a film of organic material, which is very well ordered and which we can use as our organic semiconducting layer. A secondary method that we can use is spin coating. If you think about those toys that you probably had as a kid where you dropped paint onto the substrate and spun it around, this is kind of what we're doing with spin coating, except right here we have an organic semiconductor that we're dropping onto a spinning platform instead of the paint that you probably used as a kid. So these two methods are the current methods by which we are developing organic semiconductors in our transistor. And I'm going to be talking to you about another way that we've developed in our lab to actually process organic semiconductors. And so this first method that I'm going to be talking to you about is actually laser printing. So we are able to laser print organic semiconductors, and some of the benefits of this is that it's low cost. You probably all have laser printers in your homes that you know of. It's also environmentally friendly and scalable, and it's a one-step process. So we can send a piece of paper with our device on it through the printer and print out an organic semiconducting layer using this laser printing technique. And finally, and of course the point of my whole talk, is that it's applicable to flexible substrates. So a piece of paper is flexible, and we're able to print a flexible electronic in this way. So how do we actually do this? How do we make a laser printer print out an organic semiconducting layer? Because obviously it doesn't do that right now at home. So the first step to our process is we obviously had to make a toner that would actually be semiconducting. So by combining a solvent with our organic semiconductor, we were then able to turn this solvent into a powder through some processing techniques. And this powder we then loaded into our laser printer, and we were able to print this as a toner onto our piece of paper. So a little bit to understand how this is working, I want to go through with you a little bit how a laser printer actually works. So once we load this toner into our laser printer, we send it through, and first we charge an organic photoconducting drum right over here electrically. This organic drum then rolls around towards our toner, and a laser, this is the laser printing part, prints out whatever design you want to print onto your OPC, your organic photoconducting cylinder. Right here we're printing Wake Forest University. So this right here is what is laser discharged. So when we roll the drum further around and it reaches the toner, you can see the toner right here is attracted to all the layers that we lased out. So this way, we are only going to get toner right where we printed Wake Forest University and nowhere else on the piece of paper. So this is how we're able to actually put the toner onto our piece of paper electrostatically. We further rotate the drum, and it's then transferred onto our piece of paper, which you can see coming through the printer here right now. So basically what you have right here are pieces of powder that are on top of our piece of paper. They're not completely attached to the paper yet. So we apply a fusing roller inside of your printer, and the paper rolls through this hot fusing roller, and it is then stuck to the piece of paper. And this is the important part that's good for our electronic device, is then the layers of our organic semiconductor are fused to our piece of paper or to our substrate, whatever we're printing on. So this is the process that our device went through. So by placing our device through the printer, we were actually able to create the very first laser printed OFET. So right here I have a picture of the laser printed OFET that we actually made, and these gray areas right here are where we printed out our organic semiconducting layer. So this is actually the organic semiconductor part. And you can see these graphs over here on the right look very similar to the ones that I showed you earlier, which just show us that our transistor is working well, and we actually did create an OFET. And so this is a laser printed organic field effect transistor. So what we've done in this first part of my project is created the first ever laser printed flexible transistor, and achieved a mobility and achieved processing similar to other transistors of this type. And we hope that in the future we can refine this process of toner formulation and of laser printing to make hopefully better transistors with higher mobilities in the future. So what we've done so far is we've only taken a look at this blue layer of our transistor, the organic semiconducting layer. We haven't talked about any of the other layers of our transistor. So what's going on over here? Well, the source, the drain, and the gate are often made of materials like gold or like silicon. And so these materials are very expensive. One of the ways that we actually process the gold on these materials is using an e-beam evaporator, which costs about $500,000. So this is actually how we got the gold onto our transistor earlier. And obviously this is not the cheap, low-cost processing that we were talking about earlier. So we'd like to find a way to take these yellow layers of our transistor, these gold areas, and hopefully make this process of making these layers a little bit cheaper. So how are we actually going to replace this thermal evaporation process with our e-beam evaporator with something else? And the way that we're actually going to do that is through using a conductive graphite spray paint, which costs about $30. So we actually are going to take this graphite spray paint right here and make a layer of contacts for our transistor. And one of the biggest challenges with this project is how do we actually create this layer of separation in our organic, in our OFET right here. So we need to make a grid. We need to somehow be able to spray paint our graphite on, but be able to have a grid resulting. So I'm going to take you through a bit of a process that actually uses the laser printer that we were talking about before, as well as this graphite spray, to create this grid of contacts that we're looking for. So the process that we have right now for using this graphite spray paint first starts with our substrate, where we take normal black ink toner in our laser printer and we print this onto our substrate. So you can see right here we have a black layer of toner printing a grid. We then take our graphite spray paint, this is the layer of our contacts, and we spray this on top of this layer of contacts. And what we're doing is, in all of the places that were yellow that you just saw, we're going to be able to use this as the contacts of our transistor. So by applying heat right over here on a hot plate, we cure the paint, so we allow it to dry on top of our transistor. And then, almost like the diagrams that I was showing you before in our laser printer, We then apply a piece of tin foil, aluminum foil, and use a roller to roll over the top of this substrate and allow it to press down onto the substrate. And when you actually peel back this layer of foil, what you're left with are a layer of contacts right here, which is exactly what we're looking for. So what we've done is we've used our laser printer to pattern these contacts and to remove the foil and create this grid of contacts right over here, which we're then going to be able to use as part of our transistor. So we used this method and created a OFET. And this is an image of what we've done over here. So these are the contacts. You can see the grid that we've created. And again, you have these graphs on the right, which show that our transistor is operating well and has a mobility, this figure of merit right here, that's very similar to other devices of this kind with similar organic semiconductors. So what we've actually done here is we've used this graphite spray method in combination with our laser printer to print a graphite sprayed OFET for the first time. So in these past two projects, what we've done is first, we've created a laser printing method for printing the organic semiconducting layer of our transistor, and we've created the first ever laser printed OFET. We then created a method to reduce the cost of those gold contacts that we were talking about using a graphite spray. So using this laser printer and the graphite spray, we're able to pattern our contacts and create that. And hopefully with further refinement and further research on these two methods, we'll be able to improve these and to increase the performance of our transistors in the future. And so finally, I just want to thank my entire lab, especially Peter Diemer, who I worked on this project with, and Wanda Chuchescu, who I've been working with for the past 2 years. Thank you.
Today's final presentation is from Jeremy Sexton. He is double majoring in music and the liberal arts and mathematics and minoring in Latin. Jeremy is from right here in Winston-Salem and next year will begin his studies at Duke University for a PhD in musicology. Jeremy?
Hello, everyone. I'm very happy to be here to present my senior thesis entitled Ancient Roman Brass Depictions on Imperial Monuments. I forgot the main title, Art, Instruments, and Identity. And this will be a somewhat condensed version necessarily, but first thing I'd like to do is explain why I've put brass in quotation marks here. The instruments I'm going to be talking about weren't actually made of brass, they're made of bronze, but I refer to them as brass sort of out of convenience because of their similarity to modern brass instruments like the trumpet and trombone. Specifically, they're played in the same manner by buzzing through a cup-like mouthpiece of some sort. And so I'll use the term brass instruments to describe them without reservation now. So essentially my argument in this paper is that on imperial monuments, on Roman imperial monuments, brass instruments serve as a sort of symbolic shorthand or very concise way of articulating some kind of message. And specifically, what I'm going to be talking about in this presentation is how they articulate the idea that Romans are superior to foreign peoples. They possess a kind of military prowess, a sort of military discipline and organization that their foreign foes don't have. But first, I would like to discuss my methodology a little bit. First of all, this project is based upon research that I conducted in Italy during the summer of 2016, and that was funded by a Wake Forest Richter scholarship. And so I'd like to thank the Richter Memorial Funds and the Wake Forest Richter Scholars Program, as well as the Department of Music, who provided supplemental funding. And I'd also like to thank my mentor, Dr. Stuart Carter, who sort of put me onto this topic. It was a natural topic for me personally because I play the trumpet and I have a background in studying Latin, and so those two things sort of coalesced in this project. But at any rate, once I discovered that I had an interest in ancient Roman brass instruments, the next step was for me to develop an itinerary or a way in which I could travel to Italy and study them in a methodical manner, as methodical as possible. So essentially how I did that was I did a lot of reading before I went, and these are some of the most useful sources. So I would go through these sources and find an image of an instrument or of an instrument depiction that I wanted to look at. I would have loved to have gone and studied just instruments, but unfortunately they're very few and far between, very few survive from antiquity. And so I also focused on depictions of instruments. And once I determined the places that would be beneficial for me to go, I developed an itinerary with all of these places that I traveled in the summer of 2016 over about a 5-week period. So I flew into Palermo, took a bus down to Piazza Armerina, where I studied some mosaics at a Roman villa, went back to Palermo and flew up to Naples and spent about a week in this area, then went up to Viterbo, which was an old Etruscan center. And by the way, I was also interested in any Etruscan brass instruments. The Etruscans were another ancient Italian people whose civilization began maybe 250 to 300 years before the traditional founding of Rome, but who existed contemporaneously with Rome and were eventually conquered by the Romans. And they gave the Romans a lot of the brass instruments that the Romans later used. And so I also studied their instruments, and that was what I was doing in this area. Then I spent a couple of weeks in Rome, a day each in Florence and Volterra, and then about 4 days in Bologna, one of which was a day trip to Este, and one of which was an overnight trip to Susa. And the kinds of things that I did in these various locations, I visited museums where much of the material I was interested in is housed. I visited a few archaeological sites. In particular, I was interested to see the Etruscan tomb paintings in particularly Tarquinia, because some of those have depictions of cornua. That's a particular kind of instrument. And I also visited monuments, which became the focus of my thesis when I had to narrow it down into a manageable size. So in my thesis, I focus on three monuments in particular: the Arch of Augustus at Susa, the Column of Trajan in Rome, and the Arch of Constantine, also in Rome. But for this presentation, I'd like to discuss the Column of Trajan. And let me tell you a little bit about its history. The Column of Trajan was constructed over a period of several years, but completed in 113 CE. And part of its purpose was to commemorate a pair of wars, two wars, fought by the Emperor Trajan against the Dacians, who were an ancient people living in what's now Romania. And if you look at the shaft of this column, spiraling all the way from the bottom to the top, there's a series of reliefs which form a narrative of these two military campaigns. So if you start at the bottom and wrap around and around and around and go all the way to the top, you'll supposedly get the story of these two campaigns. And among these reliefs, there are no fewer than 11 depictions of Romans playing brass musical instruments. So let's take a look at a couple of them that I think are very telling. This first example shows a group of Roman soldiers crossing a river. You can see the little waves down here at the bottom. And they're very well ordered. Everything's going very well. They're maintaining their composure and discipline. There's a brass instrument here in the center. That one is called a cornu. It's got a distinctive circular shape and a crossbar here that lets us identify it as a cornu. And one thing to note in this image, in the military context in which they were used, brass instruments were signaling devices, first and foremost. They were used by the Roman army to communicate military commands to like across large distances. And so the presence of a cornu here is really consistent with the degree of composure and organization and discipline that is demonstrated by these soldiers crossing the river. Now, thinking about crossing a river, it might not strike you as a very impressive feat, but if you compare it to this image of Dacians crossing a river elsewhere on the column, this is utter chaos. These horsemen here are, their horses are bucking them, and over here on the left-hand side, the authors of a commentary on the column have identified a horse that appears to have literally lost its head. It's just total chaos. And interestingly, the Dacians do not have the kind of discipline embodied by the Roman brass instruments, nor do any Dacian brass instruments appear in this image. And in fact, if you look all up and down the reliefs on the column, you'll see that there is not one instance of a Dacian playing a brass instrument, despite the frequency with which they occur in the depictions of Romans. So this begs the question of why. Where are the Dacians' brass instruments? Did they just not have any? Well, they did have some, and they do appear on the column, but they appear in this kind of context. This is a Roman military trophy that they've compiled from the spoils of war that they've captured from the Dacians. And so heaped at the base of this column is, well, a number of things, but included among them are two Dacian brass instruments called carnices. And this is a modern reconstruction of a carnix, so you can get a sense of what it looks like. It's characterized by this distinctive boar's head or dragon's head. That's variously interpreted by scholars. But at any rate, it has this characteristic head shape at the bell. And so you can make that out here and here. Further examples occur on the base of the column. Here's a carnix, here's another carnix. And then this object is a straight trumpet. It's a different kind of brass instrument, but nevertheless, it's a brass instrument. And so the Dacians do have instruments depicted on the column, but they have been ripped out of their hands and placed among these spoils of war. And what we can read into this these images is a sense in which the Dacians lack the symbolic agency that the Romans have, and that that is symbolized for the Romans by their brass instruments. Here are a couple more examples on the base of the column. And I think this scene encapsulates that symbolic message very nicely and concisely. So here's the Emperor Trajan. This is one of the final scenes on the column, and he's receiving the surrender of a number of Dacians who are down on their knees. They have their hands reached up to him. They're begging for mercy. And assembled behind the emperor are a group of Roman soldiers, one of which is a cornu player. There's that same instrument we saw a while ago. And in this context, as we see the surrender of these Dacian foes of the Romans, the Romans are presenting them with with the discipline and with the organization and military prowess that have enabled them to win the conflict in the first place. And so this scene sort of encapsulates the role in which the role that's occupied by the brass instruments on the column as a whole. So that's where I was planning on ending, but I see I have approximately 5 minutes left. And so I have included a couple of extra slides in case this happens, so I can talk about another dimension or two of my thinking. Here's another scene on the column depicting a particular kind of sacrifice called the sua veterilia. And the sua veterilia is characterized by a specific set of sacrificial victims. Literally, sua veterilia means pig, sheep, bull, ceremony. So the sacrificial victims are a boar or a pig, a sheep or a ram, and a bull. So you can see the pig here and the ram here. The bull is outside of the frame of this particular photograph. But they're being led in a procession around this Roman encampment, and the procession is led by brass musicians. Meanwhile, inside the encampment is Trajan himself, who's preparing to preside over the sacrifice when the ceremony is completed. He's got his hood pulled over his head. That's the garb of the Pontifex Maximus, which is the chief priest of Rome. And so in this scene, we see that brass instruments take on a religious dimension. There's a sense in which they're involved in securing the protection of the gods for the military campaign that is about to unfold. This is occurring between the two wars, at about halfway up the column. And the emperor himself is also associated with the sense of securing divine protection. And so on the column, brass instruments are not only able to embody the sense of discipline and organization that allow the Romans to win their conflict, but also they represent the securing of divine protection that ensures that the Romans are going to be victorious. And by extension, in that scene of the Dacians crossing the river, their lack of brass instruments can be seen as, can be read as a lack of divine protection. And finally, do I have time for another one? Okay. this is the following scene. And in, what's interesting about, first of all, let me describe this to you. The emperor is mounted here, and he has just crossed the Danube to embark on his second campaign. And his soldiers over here are assembled to greet him ceremoniously. Among them are two more cornu players. And so in this scene, we see sort of a foil almost to this previous one, where the emperor here is depicted in a role of religious authority, but here he is shown as a military commander, the actual physical leader of these soldiers who will bring them victory strategically and just by his presence during as they conduct their operations. And so I think this these two images help us to see how brass instruments also are intertwined with the personal authority of the emperor in securing victory, both as a military leader and as a religious leader. So I appreciate your attention, and I'm happy to share my full paper with you if you would like. I've only been able to touch on things in this presentation, but I hope you've enjoyed it, and I hope it's whetted your interest in these ancient brass instruments. Thanks.
At this time, I would like to invite all four of our presenters forward to answer questions that you all may have. So if you want to come up.
No.
It should be. Just hold it really close.
Okay. Is that working now?
Can I just
talk about that? Okay. So, yeah, and one of the things I mentioned, you trusted instruments. And so, yeah, I was really interested also in even pre Roman Republican period. So the first images I examined were from the 7th century BCE. And
there's, and in Bologna, which was an Etruscan center, there are some bronze mirrors and artifacts of various kinds in the Civic Archaeology Museum that demonstrate that brass instruments were indeed used well before the Roman Empire. There's a long history back through pre-Republican times even. And there aren't that many depictions that survive from the Republican era, but I was able to find a couple. One in the Naples Archaeology Museum, and it's a funerary relief that depicts brass instruments used in a procession that precedes a set of glass. There's another one that I wasn't able to go see.
Similar thing, showing the use in a professional context in the late Republic. far as after the good efforts, on the arch of Constantine, I discussed that in my paper. And what's interesting about that arch in particular is that it depicts civil war. It's the first Roman monument explicitly to show Romans defeating other Romans. And so in my paper, I argue that Brassus and Depictions in Constantine's army are able to characterize him as stronger.
Yes.
For Angela, we've all had place of prayers that have failed us at one time or another, and or the street or print imperfectly. And so what I'm wondering is how perfect or sort of what's the rate of perfection that you have when you're creating the sorts of electrodes and such that you have to create your neural fence. I mean, how perfect does it have to be? Is 50% success rate okay? Or, you know?
So one of the things that I didn't mention is that there are imperfections in the printing. And so one of the things that we do to try and overcome that is print multiple times. So we actually have multiple passes of the piece of paper through the laser printer, which helps with some of that. But then you can see, and I've never used a printer as often as I've used it in the past 2 years. Actually, what happens is over time, you get those vertical lines in your print, and you do have to change out the OPC drum in the different parts of the printer or clean them off to try and avoid that. So that's kind of one of the ways we overcome it. It's multiple passes, and the other one is just repair of your laser printer.
So as others are thinking of questions, I actually have a question for each of you. It's the same question. When you came to Wake Forest, did you have any idea that this is the type of research that you would be doing?
I've always loved laser printers.
Seriously, you've always loved laser printers.
No. I started as a physicist, so I actually did start in the physics department. But I started off in a biophysics lab,
okay. Actually.
So I made a little bit of a transition partway through my time at Wake Forest, which I think was just based on the circumstances of my PI. It's really just, you can get excited about anything, and when you have a professor that's excited about it, I think that really helps with getting excited about the subject. And she does a lot of other work outside, just the laser printing, of course. But yeah, I didn't really know that this is something I'd be such an expert on.
Yeah. Anybody else?
So I had a really, really good chemistry professor teacher in high school, and I originally always wanted to be a chem major, but I didn't expect to do sort of like the medicinal chemistry sort of thing that I was doing. I kind of liked chemistry because it could explain almost anything in the world. You could use chemistry to explain all sorts of different things, and so that's why I liked getting an understanding of these different processes. But working with Dr. Bierbach, he was the first person I contacted when I was told I had to find an advisor, and his project seemed really cool. I had no knowledge about it beforehand, but doing it, I'm really glad I did. Yeah, so I always wanted to do chem, but not necessarily just a chemistry or something.
So I've had an interest in education and teaching since middle school and high school. I knew that I wanted to be a teacher one day or work in education somehow. So when I started looking for ideas of research, this was the thing I was most interested in. I knew it's something I'd be able to get passionate about and really enjoy digging in, reading the literature. So for me, if I was going to do any research project, it was always going to be on schooling.
I would like to second what Angela said about having a professor who's really excited about something, really making it possible for you to get into it as well. Because before I came to Wake Forest and met Dr. Carter, I was not aware that the history of brass instruments was even a scholarly field. and since I came here, I've become a member of the Historic Brass Society and the American Musical Instrument Society, and all of these things that I didn't know even existed. And so I'm really grateful for having had that chance.
I was going to ask a question for our economist. And I think wonderfully admirable that you go into teaching in Newark, of all places, where the challenges, I'm sure, are terrific and quite difficult. Do you hope maybe someday to do something in the way of public policy that to bring your economics training into connection with your teaching in ways that might affect things on perhaps even a national level?
Right. So it's something I've thought about. I just committed to 2 years, Teach for America, the 2 year program. So I really just want to take the next 2 years to figure out really what I want to do. Definitely some sort of public service, I think, is something that I would like to do one day, whether that's working for a think tank even, or staying in education. That's what I want to figure out over the next 2 years, really.
Question here, actually. So do you have any strategies for how you're going to actually address the problems you discussed in your presentation? And additionally, how can you scale that up from the individual level to be applied to the education system?
Right. So, first of all, if anyone had the full answer, I think it would have been solved by now. And if I had the answer, I wouldn't be sitting here. That's for sure. But I think I discussed a little bit in it that even by fourth grade, you're able to see some differences. But the truth is, even by preschool, you can already start to see some differences. And there have been some public policy proposals to have universal pre-K. And I think even you hear a lot about free tuition for colleges in the news, but I think that more than that even, I think it has to be at a younger level. Pre-K would probably be more effective. That may not be as good of an issue to campaign on, or might be not as popular with voters, but if people are serious about fixing this, it has to start at a younger age.
I have a question for Tyler, and forgive me if I missed this when you were speaking, but how did the approach you ultimately went with help with the toxicity problem that you talked about?
Okay, so I kind of had the figure of like the protein purification, and so that was kind of to show loading onto protein eliminates some of the cross reaction that's going to happen, because what happens when you put gold drugs in your system is they react so fast with just various cysteines, and so cysteines are super common. On like cell surfaces, on proteins that are just circulating. And so having it already loaded onto the albumin kind of prevents some of that from happening. And then also albumin is known to bind up to 80% of gold already. And so getting that process to 100% now can help with that in just delivering the drug in particular. One last thing. I wasn't gonna really go into this because it's a little more chemistry, I guess, but the acrylamide ligand is the other side of the molecule, and that by itself has an acridine ring, which is just like three phenyl rings, and that has like cytotoxic effects itself. So what it does is it goes in the cell and it intercalates in the DNA and kills cells that way, and so eliminating that from the start also gets rid of some of that toxicity.
Well, if there are no final questions, I'd like to invite Dean of the Library, Tim Pyatt, forward for the actual award part of today.
Thanks, Molly. It's my pleasure to actually do the really fun part of this today, which is passing out the certificates and a little more tangible evidence of our appreciation for your research. This is only my second senior showcase, but I continue to be just extraordinarily impressed by the depth and sophistication of the research that you're able to do. So, you know, in many places, you're doing kind of work that you expect to see graduate students do, so I really enjoyed hearing what you're doing, and I really appreciate your sharing that. So, without further ado, Kevin, we have a little certificate of appreciation, as well as your more tangible thing. So, Tyler.
Thank you.
Angela. And Jeremy. So, my congratulations to you all.
Thank you all again for coming, and thank you especially to the faculty who inspire and encourage encourage these students every year. It is remarkable, and it makes this process for me so much fun. And I couldn't put this program on without you, so thank you for all of you. I hope you will stay and visit with our honorees. We do have a light refreshment reception for you to enjoy, and again, thank you for supporting this program and these students.